لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله ما لنا رب سوى.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونسترضيه ونستبينه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، إنه من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين سيدنا ونبينا محمد عليه أفضل الصلاة وأزكى التسليم. طبتم وطاب مشاكم وتبوأتم من الجنة منزلا. Today inshallah, tonight, this evening, we're gonna resume our reflections on Surah Yusuf. And so far, alhamdulillah, we have discussed so many verses or ayahs of the surah, and we reached the verse or ayah number 66. So today, inshallah, we're gonna start with Allah saying,
وَقَالَ يَا بَنِيَ لَا تَدْخُلُوا مِنْ بَابٍ وَاحِدٍ وَدْخُلُوا مِنْ أَبْوَابٍ مُتَفَرِّقَةٍ.
This is the advice. This is the piece of advice that was given by Prophet Yaqub sallallahu alayhi wasallam to his sons. After they persuaded him, after they managed to persuade him and to persuade him to let Benjamin go with them to Egypt in order to meet with Aziz of Egypt, Prophet Yusuf sallallahu alayhi wasallam, without knowing that.
وَقَالَ يَا بَنِيَّ لَا تَدْخُلُوا مِنْ بَابٍ وَاحِدٍ وَدْخُلُوا مِنْ أَبْوَابٍ مُتَفَرِّقَةٍ.
And he said, O my sons, don't enter by one gate, but enter by different gates. That was the piece of advice. But here we have a question. It's a very, very delicate and important question. Why did Prophet Yaqub sallallahu alayhi wasallam advise his sons to enter Egypt by different gates and different doors, rather than all of them entering Egypt from one or by one gate? Why? Why did he do that or say that? Yes? Sorry? Al-Hasad. So he was fearful for them, for the evil eye. He was fearful. This is what many scholars say. Many scholars say that he was fearful for them, for the evil eye, because the evil eye can affect anyone by or with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because some people believe that the evil eye can affect anyone or harm anyone, even without, you know, by itself or by the influence or the impact of the jinn. But this is not true. This is not true. This is incorrect, because nothing takes place in this whole universe. Nothing happens in this whole universe without Allah's will, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if there is an evil eye and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills it to cause any harm, it will cause a harm. But if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prevents it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't will it to cause any harm to anyone, it will never be able or manage to cause any harm to anyone. But why, again, why did Prophet Yaqub say that? Because they were very handsome. They were very, very handsome. And do you remember Prophet Yusuf himself? He was given a half of beauty, right? He was given a half of beauty, and he is the son of a prophet, and his father is the son of a prophet, and his father is the son of a prophet. So he is the noble, the son of the noble, the son of the noble, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in one of his traditions or hadith. So all of them were very handsome, all of them, they were very elegant, and he was fearful for them from the evil eye.
وَمَا أُغْنِي عَنْهُ وَقَالَ يَا بَنِيَ لَا تَدْخُلُوا مِنْ بَابٍ وَاحِدٍ وَادْخُلُوا مِنْ أَبْوَابٍ مُتَفَرِّقَةٍ وَمَا أُغْنِي عَنْكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ.
He knew this, and he said that this precaution will not avail them anything. This precaution will not avail them anything if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills anything else. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills for them anything, this will afflict them and this will befall them. And this precaution will never protect them against the decree or the decision or the judgment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ولما دخلوا من حيث أمرهم أبوهم ما كان يغني عنهم من الله من شيء إلا حاجة في نفس يعقوب قضاها وإنه لذو علم لما علمناه ولكن أكثر الناس لا يعلمون. And when they entered according to their father's advice, they followed the piece of advice that they were given by their father, Prophet Yaqub sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And when they entered according to their father's advice, it didn't avail them in the least against the will of Allah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had another scheme for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala planned something for them. As you remember, Prophet Yusuf, he was inspired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that his brothers, they have to be given a lesson. They have to be educated and given a lesson. Why? Because till now, after 40, or according to other scholars, after 80 years, they never repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They never repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They never showed any remorse or regret because of what, or due to, or because of what they did to their brother, Prophet Yusuf, so many years ago. So they had to be taught a lesson. ولما دخلوا من حيث أمرهم أبوهم ما كان يغني عنهم من الله من شيء. It didn't avail them in the least against the will of Allah. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills anything to happen, to take place, it will definitely happen and take place. It was but a need of Yaqub's inner self which he discharged. إلا حاجة في نفس يعقوب قضاها. The Quran doesn't reveal this thing. The Quran doesn't tell us about this thing that was in the soul or in the self of Prophet, the inner self of Prophet Yaqub. The Quran doesn't explain this. The Quran keeps this as it is, something which is not open. It's not known to anyone. And had the Quran willed or wished to divulge this and to make this thing known to us, no one could ever prevent Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the Quran from doing that. But because the Quran kept it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept it to himself and kept it to the self of Prophet Yaqub, so we don't have to waste our energy looking for commentaries and looking for stories behind this and looking for explanations for an explanation for this, as so many scholars did. They have said so many things concerning that, but we don't have to concern ourselves with all these things, and we have to stick to the style of the Quran. So whenever the Quran tells us anything in detail, we have to go and to flow with these details and to learn from them. And whenever the Quran gives us the piece of information in a concise way, we have to respect this. And we have to learn a lesson from this as well. If you have one of your parents, your spouse, your wife, or your husband, even your son or your daughter or your friend, if he wants to tell you something or if he wants to give you the details of anything, be a good listener. But if he prefers to keep the details to himself, you have to respect that. We have to respect the privacy of others. And we have to respect their feelings regarding anything that we are discussing or talking about. We have to learn this. وَلَمَّا دَخَلُوا مِنْ حَيْثُ أَمَرَهُمْ أَبُوهُمْ مَا كَانَ يُغْنِي عَنْهُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ إِلَّا حَاجَةً فِي نَفْسِ يَعْقُوبَ قَضَاهَا وَإِنَّهُ لَذُو عِلْمٍ لِمَا عَلَّمْنَاهُ. And really, he was endowed with knowledge because we had taught him. He was a prophet. So he had been given or granted divine knowledge by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he knew so many things that even his sons didn't know. And we have to respect this.
وإنه لذو علم لما علمناه ولكن أكثر الناس لا يعلمون.
But most men know not. Most men know not anything, do not know anything about these things that we taught Ya'qub صلى الله عليه وسلم.
إن الحكم إلا لله عليه توكلت وعليه فليتوكل المتوكلون. ولما دخلوا على يوسف آوى إليه أخاه قال إني أنا أخوك فلا تبتئس بما كانوا يعملون.
And when they went in before Yusuf, he took his brother Benjamin to himself and said, Verily, I am your brother, so grieve not for what they used to do. I have a question for you. Can you imagine that? Or is it true that immediately after they enter or they come into the place where Prophet Yusuf resided, immediately he takes his full brother Benjamin aside and he starts to give him a private talk or something like that? Or there must have been some time that passed, right? So he received them, Prophet Yusuf, he received them, he welcomed them, and he honored them, and he was very, very hospitable with them. And after honoring them, he seized the opportunity to take his brother, his full brother Benjamin, aside, and he started to talk to him in private. And he explained the plan to him, because he needed Benjamin to be aware of the plan or aware of what he would do in order for him to be able to keep Benjamin with him in Egypt, because that was part of the lesson he intended to teach his brothers. So, and when they went in before Yusuf, he took his brother Benjamin to himself and said, Verily, I am your brother. So grieve not for what they used to do. But here there's another question. We said that there must have been a time lapse, a duration, a period of time between receiving them and welcoming them and between him taking his brother Benjamin aside, right? But why does the Quran tell us about this, that he immediately started talking to Benjamin? Why? Why didn't the Quran give us the impression that he waited till the right moment to speak to his brother in private? Why? Yes? Sorry? It wasn't important? Two?
MashaAllah, MashaAllah, this is a very good explanation. Jazakumullah khairan. We don't have any cans. Oh, I'm so sorry. Next time, inshallah. Make sure you come next time. This is a very good explanation, but there is another explanation as well. The other explanation is that the surah or the Quran here tells us that Prophet Yusuf, he talked or conversed with his brother immediately because that was the first thought. It was the first thought that came or crossed the mind of Prophet Yusuf when he saw his brothers entering his place. So, because that was the first thought in his mind, it was the first action that is mentioned in the Quran. So there is some sort of compatibility here. Because it was the first thought, so it's the first action to be mentioned in the surah or in the verses. Jazakumullahu khairan.
Q قال إني أنا أخوك. I am your brother. فلا تبتئس. Don't grieve. Grieve not. بما كانوا يعملون. And they remembered what their brothers did to them, to both of them. And he is saying, he is advising them. Prophet Yusuf is advising his brother Benjamin not to grieve over what they did to Yusuf so many years ago, because they took him away from his father and they threw him into the bottom of the well and they caused him to be sold as a slave, and even after that he was imprisoned for so many years, right? So he went through so many hardships, and Prophet Yusuf is alleviating the feelings of his own brother, who haven't witnessed any of these. See who is alleviating the feelings of the other? It was Prophet Yusuf who went through all these hardships. He was the one who was alleviating the feelings of his brother Benjamin. And he's advising him not to grieve and to be patient, and don't let them know anything about our scheme until it's gonna be divulged to them, all of them. قال إني أنا أخوك فلا تبتئس بما كانوا يعملون. فلما جهزهم بجهازهم جعل السقاية في رحل أخيه. So now, after welcoming them and after honoring them and after being hospitable with them, he now is providing them with the provisions, with the food provisions and the food supplies they came to request. And remember, they came from the land of Canaan, because the land of Canaan and all the surrounding neighboring areas were struck by drought as well. So they came in order to seek food supplies for themselves and for their families. فَلَمَّا جَهَزَهُمْ بِجَهَازِهِمْ When he provided them with the food supplies, جَعَلَ السِّقَايَةَ فِي رَحْلِ أَخِيهِ He ordered his servants or his slaves to put the goblet, the king's goblet, the instrument that was used for weighing the grain and the wheat. And it is said that, scholars say that, that goblet was made of gold. It was golden, and it was made of gold. It was very, very precious, and it was used by the king himself for drinking. The king used to drink using this instrument. And because grain and wheat became a great fortune for Egypt, and it was measured as gold used to be measured, they used the bottom of this goblet in order to weigh the grain and to the wheat. And this gives us an idea about how precious grain and food back then was to those people. Because it was without that food, all of them, or nearly all of them, would starve to death and would die. So, فَلَمَّا جَهَزَهُمْ بِجَهَازِهِمْ جَعَلَ السِّقَايَةَ فِي رَحْلِ أَخِيهِ He ordered his servants or his slaves to put or to insert, stealthily to insert that goblet or that king's bowl into the bag of his brother Benjamin. ثُمَّ أَذَّنَ مُؤَذِّنٌ An announcer started to make an announcement. ثُمَّ أَذَّنَ مُؤَذِّنٌ أَيَّتُهَا الْعِيرُ All the people of the caravan, all the people of Canaan, the people of caravan, أَيَّتُهَا الْعِيرُ إِنَّكُمْ لَسَارِقُونَ You are thieves. You have stolen something from us. Come back. Don't go away. We have to search you, all of you, because we have lost something which is very, very precious to us. فَلَمَّا جَهَزَهُمْ بِجَهَازِهِمْ جَعَلَ السِّقَايَةَ فِي رَحْلِ أَخِيهِ ثُمَّ أَذَّنَ مُؤَذِّنٌ أَيَّتُهَا الْعِيرُ إِنَّكُمْ لَسَارِقُونَ قَالُوا وَأَقْبَلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ مَاذَا تَفْقِدُونَ They were taken by surprise. And by the way, here in these ayahs, in this episode of the surah, we witness or we see something which is called in literature or in literature terminology the climax. We have a story, and the story is going bit by bit until it reaches that climax, that when things were the actions and when the incidents become very, very heated. And here is the climax of that story. Now, we find the sons of a prophet the sons of a prophet, the sons of Prophet Yaqub, and they are accused of being thieves. Now they are accused of trying to spread mischief in the land of Egypt, which became back then the storehouse for food for all the neighboring countries. And it was something big. قالوا وأقبلوا عليهم ماذا تفقدون. They said, and they came back to them. They directed their faces towards the one who made the announcement. قالوا وأقبلوا عليهم ماذا تفقدون. What is it that you have lost? And from the question itself, we can see that they were innocent and they are trying to show their innocence through forming this question. Because if someone steals something, for sure he knows what is that thing, right? What the entity of that thing, what the nature of this thing. But here, they are being accused by an announcer that they have stolen something. And for them to ask him, what is it that you have lost? So they are implicitly, indirectly telling him that we don't have any idea about what you're talking about. What is it that you have lost? قالوا وأقبلوا عليهم ماذا تفقدون. And the word وأقبلوا عليهم, they directed their faces towards them and they started to move back towards them. This means that they haven't tried to escape or to flee or to go to the other direction. But they went back. Why? Because they were very, very certain about their innocence. They have never stolen anything before, right? قالوا وأقبلوا عليهم ماذا تفقدون. قالوا, the announcer or anyone else from the courtiers or from the people of the servants and the officials who worked for Prophet Yusuf sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. قالوا نفقد صواع الملك. We lost the king's goblet, the king's bowl, which we used to weigh the grains and the wheat and the food for the people. قالوا نفقد صواع الملك ولمن جاء به حمل بعير. And for the one who produces it, for the one who returns it back to us, he's gonna be given a camel load of food or a camel load of grain. And as you remember, we said that Prophet Yusuf used to give each family man one camel load of food for a whole year. So here we're talking about a fortune. We're talking about a great treasure. We're talking about a food supplies for a whole year for a whole family. So you can imagine the reward. قالوا نفقد صواع الملك ولمن جاء به حمل بعير وأنا به زعيم. I'm the guarantor. I guarantee that anyone who would return the king's goblet to us, or this golden goblet to us, I'm quite certain that he's gonna receive this reward. For sure, he's gonna receive this reward from me. And scholars say it was Prophet Yusuf sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who said that because he was witnessing what was happening back then or at this very moment. قالوا نفقد صواع الملك ولمن جاء به حمل بعير وأنا به زعيم. قالوا, Prophet Yusuf's brothers, they replied, they answered, they responded. قالوا تالله. They started to make an oath. They started to make an oath. قالوا تالله, والله, by Allah, by God. قالوا تالله لقد علمتم ما جئنا لنفسد في الأرض وما كنا سارقين. لقد علمتم. How did the people of Egypt, how did the Aziz of Egypt and his men know that they were not here to make mischief in the land? How? Because they met with them twice. They met with them twice. Last year and this current year, right? And they stayed for some time with them. And they saw their character. They saw them, they dealt with them, they spoke with them, and they dealt with them, and they knew for sure that they were the sons of a prophet. So it wasn't part of their character to be thieves. They told that to themselves and to the people. قالوا تالله لقد علمتم, out of the dealings, out of our transactions with one another. قالوا تالله لقد علمتم ما جئنا لنفسد في الأرض. We only came here to request food supplies for our families. And we never thought of making or about making any mischief or causing any mischief in the land of Egypt. قالوا تالله لقد علمتم ما جئنا لنفسد في الأرض وما كنا سارقين. We are no thieves. We never stole anything before, and we are not stealing anything, and we will never be thieves. We will never steal anything from anyone, because we know that theft is unlawful, theft is haram. In all the legislations, in all the sharia's that were revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to human beings, theft is haram, right? It's unlawful. قالوا تالله لقد علمتم ما جئنا لنفسد في الأرض وما كنا سارقين. قالوا, Prophet Yusuf's man, the announcer or anyone else, قالوا فما جزاؤه إن كنتم كاذبين. What is the punishment of the one who stole from us if we discover that he is one of you? So, if it is discovered that the thief is one of you, so what is the punishment for him? We're gonna judge him according to your law, not according to the law of the king of Egypt. So that was an agreement. That was an agreement. It was a proposition on the part of Prophet Yusuf and his men to them, and they agreed. If we discover that, if it will become known that the thief is one from among you, so we're gonna judge him according to the law of you, your law, the law of Prophet Yaqub and Prophet Ibrahim, and not the law prescribed by the king of Egypt. قالوا فما جزاؤه إن كنتم كاذبين. If you are liars, if you are telling a lie, and if you are the thieves, or one of you is the thief, one of you is the one who stole the golden goblet of the king. قالوا فما جزاؤه إن كنتم كاذبين. قالوا, Yusuf's brothers, قالوا جزاؤه من وجد في رحله فهو جزاؤه. Anyone you find in his bag the golden goblet of the king, it's gonna be his punishment to be held as a captive, as a slave. And that was the law of Prophet, of the people of Prophet Ibrahim and Prophet Yaqub, that anyone who steals anything from anyone else, the thief is gonna be held or should be held as a slave or a captive to the victim. So the victim of theft takes the thief as his slave. And that wasn't the law of the king of Egypt. And we're gonna know in a few minutes, inshallah, why did Prophet Yusuf did that? Why did Prophet Yusuf sallallahu alayhi wasallam ask them to punish the thief according to their law and not according to the law of the king of Egypt? قالوا جزاؤه من وجد في رحله فهو جزاؤه. So, anyone you find the goblet with him should be held as a slave or a captive in return for his theft, in return for his crime. قالوا جزاؤه من وجد في رحله فهو جزاؤه كذلك نجزي الظالمين. This is the way we punish the thieves or the wrongdoers. And if you commit a theft, then you are a wrongdoer for sure, right? Theft is not a good deed, right? So, كَذَلِكَ نَجِزِ الظَّالِمِينَ. This is the way we punish the wrongdoers in our law, according to our law, according to the law of Prophet Yaqub and Prophet Ibrahim. So this is the punishment. And they agreed on that. قَالُوا جَزَاؤُهُ مَنْ وُجِدَ فِي رَحْلِهِ فَهُوَ جَزَاؤُهُ كَذَلِكَ نَجِزِ الظَّالِمِينَ. فبدأ بأوعيتهم قبل وعاء أخيه ثم استخرجها من وعاء أخيه كذلك كدنا ليوسف. See how smart Prophet Yusuf was, صلى الله عليه وسلم. And why not? He was a prophet and a messenger, right? So he must have been very, very smart. Very, very smart. And part of his smartness was that, or intelligence was that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him the interpretation of statements. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the faculty to interpret statements. And as we said in our second lecture, this means that either the interpretation of dreams or that he was very intelligent and very smart, so that whenever he hears even the beginning of a story, he knows the end of it. He knows the outcome of the statements. Whenever he hears something, he knows what's behind the lines. What's behind the lines and what's between the lines. So he was very smart for sure. فَبَدَأَ بِأَوَيَاتِهِمْ That's why he didn't, when he started to search, when he started to search the bags of the brothers, he didn't start with searching the bag of Benjamin. He knew for sure that he was certain that the golden goblet was inserted in the bag that belongs to Benjamin himself. But in order not to raise any doubts about his plan, so he started searching the bags of the brothers before searching the bag that belongs to Benjamin himself. فَبَدَأَ بِأَوْعِيَتِهِمْ قَبْلَ وِعَاءِ أَخِيهِمْ ثم استخرجها ثم. In Arabic we have prepositions, conjunctions. We have أحرف العطف conjunctions, and one of the conjunctions is where, which means that when we say جاء محمد وعمر. Muhammad and Amr came. This may mean that they came together. So there is no time lapse between the coming of Muhammad and the coming of Amr. They came together. They came at the same time. But if we say جاء محمد فعمر, this means that Muhammad came and immediately after him came Amr. But if we say جاء محمد ثم عمر, this means that Muhammad came in and then maybe after a few minutes and maybe after a few hours the other person came. So here when the Quran says فَبَدَأَ بِأَوْعِيَتِهِمْ قَبْلَ وِعَاءِ أَخِيهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَخْرَجَهَا, this means that he didn't fake it when he was searching their bags, but he searched the bags thoroughly and he gave it the due time, and he did it in a very proper way in order not to raise any doubts. So he took his time and his men took their time in searching the bags of the brothers, and then they took it out from the bag that belonged to Benjamin. Wallahi, if we are shooting a movie in Hollywood, The producer wouldn't be that meticulous. But in the Quran, because this is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is one of the finest stories, one of the best stories, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the same story, نحن نقص عليك أحسن القصص, the best of stories. And indeed, wallahi, it is the best of stories. فَبَدَأَ بِأَوْعِيَتِهِمْ قَبْلَ وِعَاءِ أَخِيهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَخْرَجَهَا مِنْ وِعَاءِ أَخِيهِ كَذَلِكَ كِدْنَا لِيُوسُفِ. It wasn't Yusuf's plan. It wasn't Yusuf's scheme. It was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who contrived this plan. It was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who taught or inspired Prophet Yusuf to carry out the plan as thus. This way. So it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who planned and schemed for Prophet Yusuf. كَذَلِكَ كِدْنَا لِيُوسُفِ. And by the way, the word كَادَ, kidna from the word al-kaid. And the al-kaid, al-kaid, قال إنه من كيدكن. This is out of your guile. The word kaid in Arabic is a malicious word. It's an evil word. It's not a good word. The word kaid in لغة عربية, when you عندما تكيد لإنسان, عندما تكيد لإنسان, when you scheme something against someone else, so you are intending to inflict some harm upon him. But this doesn't conform to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the plans of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never does any wrong to anyone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never wrongs anyone and never inflicts any harm upon anyone. Right? So why did the Quran use this word, kaid? كَذَلِكَ كِدْنَا لِيُوسُفَ. Because on the surface, it seemed to the brothers and to Benjamin as an evil thing. But inside this incident, inside this plan, it was full of mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Prophet Yusuf, to Benjamin, to the brothers, and to Prophet Yaqub. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intended or planned that all of them were going to be reunited in no time. Right? So that was the takhteet, the planning of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That was part of the strategic planning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired Prophet Yusuf with. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. كَذَلِكَ كِدْنَا لِيُوسُفَ مَا كَانَ لِيَأْخُذَ أَخَاهُ فِي دِينِ الْمَلِكِ إِلَّا أَيَّشَاءَ اللَّهُ. He wouldn't be able to take his brother. And the word deen here, fi deen al-malik, we always, and many translators who translate from between Arabic and English, they use the word religion to denote or to refer to the word deen. But here, the word deen, ما كان ليأخذ أخاه في دين الملك, means the system of the king. The system that governed the political life and the social life and everything in Egypt back then. ما كان ليأخذ أخاه في دين الملك إلا أن يشاء الله. So it was the scheme, it was the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because in the Sharia, in the system, in the governing system of the king, Prophet Yusuf wouldn't be able to hold his brother Benjamin as his slave or captive with him in return for his theft. According to the law of the king, he would only be able to punish him for the theft. Only to punish him by, you know, giving him lashes or imprisoning him for a certain period of time or something like that. But to keep him with him in Egypt as his slave, that wouldn't be possible. That couldn't have been possible for Prophet Yusuf to do that without resorting to or adjudicating to the laws of Prophet Ibrahim and Prophet Yaqub, to their people, the law of their people. ما كان ليأخذ أخاه في دين الملك إلا أن يشاء الله. And Prophet Yusuf sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him this. نرفع درجات من نشاء. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises Prophet Yusuf, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who taught him this. It was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who taught him this and who told him about that. نرفع درجات من نشاء. So whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves his slave and his worshiper and wants to bestow upon him out of his grace, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him knowledge. نرفع درجات من نشاء وفوق كل ذي علم عليم. And above every knowledgeable person there is the all-knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by the way, there are two interpretations of this piece or this part of the ayah. وفوق كل ذي علم عليم. Once Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas, he was narrating a hadith by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to some of the Sahaba and some of the Tabi'een. And one of the attendees, one of the people who were present back then, he said, MashaAllah, that's amazing. وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. He meant that Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas was one of the most knowledgeable persons on earth. And he was. But Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas, he rebuked him and he reproached him and he blamed him for saying that. And he interpreted this verse, he interpreted this part of the verse as thus. وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. Above all the scholars, above all the knowledgeable persons in this whole universe, there is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who knows everything. And for sure you remember when Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met with Al-Khadr, and they went aboard the ship and they saw the Al-Khadr, he saw a sparrow, a little bird. And the little bird came and he stood on the edge of the ship, and he inserted its beak into the water and drank and took, you know, a drop of water. And Al-Khadr told Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wasallam that my knowledge and your knowledge, and here we're talking about a righteous man whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave so many of his divine knowledge, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we're talking about a prophet, one of the five greatest prophets sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide humanity to the right path. And he is Kalimullah, he's the one to whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke, right? So Al-Khadr tells him that, my knowledge and your knowledge, Prophet Musa's knowledge, compared to the knowledge of Allah, is just like the amount of water that this little sparrow took out of the ocean. Nothing. Which is nothing. So the knowledge that can be attained by this whole universe, by the people in this whole universe, generation after generation, are nothing when they are compared to the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. نَرْفَعُ دَرَجَاتٍ مَنْ نَشَاءُ وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. Just one ayah. قَالُوا إِنْ يَسْرِقْ فَقَدْ سَرَقَ أَخٌ لَهُ مِنْ قَبْلِ. They said, If he is proved, they are talking about Benjamin, if he is proved to be a thief, so this is something which is not unprecedented. This happened before, because he had a brother, Yusuf, and he stole before. This part of the verse of the ayah tells us that they were still harboring grudge against Prophet Yusuf and his brother. And they wanted to acquaint themselves. They wanted to prove themselves innocent. And they wanted to detach themselves from this branch of the family, because they all came from one mother, and the Prophet Yusuf and his brother Benjamin came from another branch, right? So they were saying that, if he is proven to be a thief, so, and his brother, his false brother, stole before, so the thieves in our family belong only to this branch, but we are innocent. We have nothing to do with this. You can imagine. قَالُوا إِنْ يَسْرِقْ فَقَدْ سَرَقَ أَخٌ لَهُ مِنْ قَبْلِ. And scholars talked a lot and discussed a lot and gave so many legends and so many stories about the explanation of this. What was the theft that Prophet Yusuf was accused of? Some of them said that he used to joke with one of his aunts, and she used to worship an idol and he stole it. Things. And others said that it was one of his aunts, and because we said it was part of the law that governed the life of the people of Canaan, was that any thief should be held as a slave. So one of his aunts, she loved Prophet Yusuf very much, and she faked it, and she said that she claimed that he stole something from her in order for her to be able to keep him with her in her house. They say these things, but the Quran, you know, doesn't concern itself with all these details. قالوا إيه يسرق فقد سرق أخ له من قبل فأسرها يوسف في نفسه ولم يبدها لهم. Prophet Yusuf kept this to himself, and he never revealed it, and he never allowed his face to show the inner feelings. فأسرها يوسف في نفسه ولم يبدها لهم. قال أنتم شر مكانا. You are in a very bad situation. You are in a very, very bad situation now. فأسرها يوسف في نفسه ولم يبدها لهم. قال أنتم شر مكانا والله أعلم بما تصفون. Allah سبحانه وتعالى knows what you are describing. And here we have two interpretations as well. فأسرها يوسف في نفسه. Some scholars say that he kept it to himself. Which what did he keep for himself? It was the false accusation that he stole before. قالوا إن يسرق فقد سرق أخ له من قبل. And that was an accusation for Prophet Yusuf himself, right? So he kept it to himself and didn't want to reveal or to let his facial countenance to reveal his inner feelings. And others said that no, it was. فأسرها يوسف في نفسه ولم يبدها لهم. He kept it to himself and didn't say it loudly. That was the following statement. The following statement, which is قال أنتم شر مكانا, that you are in a very bad situation. They say he didn't utter these words, but he intended. These words were within himself, and he felt them within himself, within in his heart, but he never uttered them. He never articulated these words. So, فَأَسَرَّهَا, maybe the accusation, and maybe the following statement. And here, the scholars say that the brothers accused Prophet Yusuf of committing sin, theft, right? And they say, some of them say that. Many scholars forgot that those sons, those brothers of Prophet Yusuf, they lied to their father before, so many years ago. They lied to him and they told him that Yusuf was eaten or devoured by a wolf. Now, right? And what prevents them from lying to the king of Egypt now? So Prophet Yusuf never committed a theft, but they were only lying, as they used to do before, because they never repented. Yes? MashaAllah. Yes. Jazakum khair. Shakar Allah lak. So, قالوا إن يسرق فقد سرق أخ له من قبل فأسرها يوسف في نفسه ولم يبدها لهم قال أنتم شر مكانا. You are in a very bad situation in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you are still telling lies. And now you are the accusers. You are the accusers of Yusuf, but you are in a very bad situation. It's a worse situation than the situation in which Yusuf and his brother Benjamin are in. Wallahu a'lamu bima tasifun. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all aware of what you describe and of what you say and accuse the innocent with. Jazakumullah khairan. And inshallah, next week we're going to continue, inshallah. شكر الله لكم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك, نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت, نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. جزاكم الله خيرا، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.